11 and 12, Jesus faces this gauntlet of all the different religious leaders in Jerusalem. Mark deliberately records at least one encounter with each one. So you see that in chapter 11, verse 27 onwards, his authority is challenged by the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Then in verse 13, some Pharisees and Herodians come. Verse 18, Sadducees came. Verse 28, the scribes came. And so we're deliberately getting a snapshot encounter with each one of these groups. In chapter 12, we've got three groups to face. And the first thing I want you to notice in these verses is an unlikely alliance. The next challenge comes from Pharisees and Herodians, and these men were not natural friends. So the Pharisees believed Israel's salvation lay in keeping God's law. They were so devoted to keeping the law that they added hundreds of their own rules to protect them from breaking the law accidentally. And so you imagine a delivery driver who's so nervous about his cargo, he just puts padding and layers of heavy protection on, so much that he can't even move the trailer by the time it's time to take it somewhere. And so the Pharisees, with their extra regulations, made law-keeping an unbearable burden. Now, the Herodians believed that Israel could only survive by collaborating with the Romans. So the Pharisees are purists who hated Rome. The Herodians are pragmatists working with Rome. Now, during teacher training, I used to get a lift into work with my friend Rob, who was a devout Catholic. And we'd have these long, heated discussions, arguments, conversations, until we picked up Matt, a science teacher and an atheist. Then Matt had a real hard time. See, these men who didn't normally come together have joined forces to tackle Jesus. Next, notice a deeper evil. Look at the start of verse 13. And they sent to him some of the Pharisees and Herodians. Don't miss that. There's now a group, a defined network, actively trying to destroy Jesus, sending men to trip him up. We met them in chapter 11, verse 18. The chief priests and the scribes heard it and were seeking a way to destroy him. And it follows on just logically in the text that that's who we're talking about. The authority of Jesus is challenged, verse 27. He tells them, neither will I do these things. Chapter 12, he began to speak to them at the end of verse 12 of chapter 12. So they left him and went away after hearing the parable. Verse 13, and they sent to him some of the Pharisees and Herodians. So it's these chief priests and scribes who've tried to take him on themselves but failed dismally. Now they send others to trap him. I want you to see next that terrible trap, verse 13, the second half of it. Imagine a deer tiptoeing through the woods and it smells something tasty. It finds the bait. And after it's checked around for predators, it lets its guard down just that little bit. And before it knows it, around its leg snaps up the steel jaws of a trap, digging in on both sides. The other deer hear it, they flee, and so the animal's trapped, alone, and vulnerable. That's exactly what these men have in mind for Jesus. Let me show you what I mean. First, see the bait. Verse 14, they came to Jesus, said to him, "Teacher, we know that you are true. You do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances." They begin with bait, with flattery, trying to get Jesus to let his guard down. You notice a triple irony here. First, everything they say is true. You know, flattery is dangerous because it gives us an unrealistic view of ourselves. But everything these men say about Jesus is completely true. Notice three I's. First is integrity. They say, "We know you are true." In other words, your talk matches your walk. Now, if you were to say that to me afterwards, "Oh, Pastor, you're so great. Your talk matches your walk," I'd have to say to you, "You don't know my heart. You don't know me very well at all. The only reason I dare preach to you on a Sunday is because I've preached to myself all through the week." But Jesus is the only preacher in history whose walk truly matched his talk. When he said that the greatest command is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's exactly what he had done every day of his life. The second I is impartiality. You do not care about anyone's opinion, for you're not swayed by appearances. Samuel Davis was preaching for King George III when the king turned to his wife and out loud complimented something that Davis had said. Well, mid-flow, Davis stopped, paused, stared at the king, and said, "When the lion roars, the beasts of the forest tremble. When Jehovah speaks, let the kings of earth keep their silence." That's a brave man. There's a gospel preacher who believed that God was speaking through what he was saying. The Lord Jesus knew God was speaking when he was speaking. He wasn't intimidated by powerful men, nor was he aloof from the poorest. He loved all. But the only opinion he cared about was God's. The Pharisees saw that. They knew that. The third eye is inspired. They say, "But you truly teach the way of God." When Jesus spoke, it wasn't like the scribes who explained the Old Testament with all the enthusiasm of a substitute maths teacher. Jesus' words were alive with divine authority and Holy Spirit power. He wouldn't shy away from tough subjects, from hard passages, but he spoke God's word. The second irony is that these men were nothing like that. You know, for all their compliments. Second irony is everything they admire in Jesus, they are totally lacking. Their walk does not match their talk. They live for man's opinion, and when they speak, it's dry and impotent. The third of the three-level irony is that the things that they praise Jesus for are the very things that are making their lives difficult. The whole reason that they've come to trap Jesus is that his integrity, impartiality, and inspired preaching are threatening their power. What do we take from that? Well, on my bookshelf at home, there are two volumes of collected tracts and leaflets that were written in the 19th century to convince people to believe in Jesus. And the last one in the collection is titled "Tributes to Jesus from Famous People Not Known to Be Christians." And there is a little bit in every single one of us that would kind of be content if people would just admire Jesus. We love the idea of maybe the church being in the paper. We've done something good. Imagine if Prime Minister stood up and said, "There's a little church down in Wyndham and they're doing great work in their community." We'd love it if just 80%, imagine 80% of Wyndham just came and sat here on a Sunday and nodded in approval. I was preaching in Clinton not long ago, and when I'd finished, there was a time of sharing, and somebody stood up and he said, "The most significant thing I've heard today is that both Theresa May, the British Prime Minister, and Angela Merkel, the German Chancellor, were raised in Christian homes." In other words, they've got a sympathy, they've got a respect for Christianity, but that's not significant at all. The reality we've seen in Mark's gospel again and again and here in this passage is that you can say all the right things about Jesus and still be his enemy. Hell is full of men and women who say Jesus is a good man, who recognized his integrity, impartiality, and inspired words. There will even be some who called him Lord. See, with God, flattery gets you nowhere. If God's goal was the praise of mouths, he would have stayed in heaven and basked in the adoration of angels. But he came to earth, not for the approval of man, not for us to give him the nod of acceptance. But he came for love of God and of a sin-ruined world. He didn't come for your lip service, but your heart's worship. And so it would be wicked for me or for any church to be content with your kind approval of our congregation or our Lord Jesus. For the sake of God's glory and your soul, the gospel insists on confession of sin, repentance, and belief in Jesus Christ as your only hope of escaping hell. Next, I want you to see the trap in verse 14. We've seen the bait, now see this trap. They came to Jesus, said to him, "Teacher," and then it comes to this question, is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay them or should we not? Just like those steel jaw leg traps, there's a double edge to the Pharisees' plot. They come to Jesus with this question that's such a hot topic. And I don't want you to underestimate the genius of the Pharisees. They're not bumbling idiots. In fact, they've been watching Jesus and they've learned from him. They saw how he put the priests in that unwinnable position. You know, tell me, where did John's authority come from? And I will tell you where mine comes from. And now they're doing exactly the same to him. So you remember the census that took Joseph and Mary to Bethlehem. That census led to a poll tax of every Jew in the Roman Empire. Every Jew from then on had to pay a day's wages every year to Rome. Now, nobody likes taxes, but the Jews hated this one. They hated the coins with Caesar's face, a constant reminder of Roman occupation. They hated the words on the coins declaring Caesar a son of God. They hated the men that collected the coins and their extortionate rates. They hated paying to live in the land that God had given them. And they hated that any attempt to avoid paying was met with swift, violent retribution. The trap is laid. Should we pay? If Jesus says yes, one side of the trap comes up. The Pharisees denounce him as a collaborator, and he'll lose most of his followers. If he says no, the other side of the trap swings up. The Herodians run the 100 meters to the Roman fort, and the troops come and take rebel Jesus away. It's a brilliant trap. But Jesus is more brilliant. Verse 15, he sees their hypocrisy, and yet he stands firm in the truth. He doesn't turn away. He doesn't say, "I'm not answering that question." He doesn't sound so angry as disappointed. "Why put me to the test?" He's asking them, "Oh, surely you see this as evil. Question the motive of your heart. You've come here to have me murdered. Surely you get that that's wrong." He still loves these wicked men. He longs they'd see their folly and repent. He loves you who come with flattering lips and yet cold, hard hearts. See the tables turned, verse 15 through to 17. Knowing their hypocrisy, he said to them, "Why put me to the test? Bring me a denarius. Let me look at it." They bought one. He said to them, "Whose likeness and inscription is this?" They said, "Caesar's." Jesus said to them, "Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." And they marveled at him. There's a great video on YouTube of a little cliffside where there's some deer feeding and there's some explosives laid as well to clear some trees out the way. The whole thing is about to be destroyed. And it seems as if the deer is just right over the top of the explosion. The whole thing goes up in smoke, and yet amazingly you see this little animal skip away as if it hasn't been hurt at all. And well, that's the Lord Jesus here. He springs out of the trap, and the hunters are left gawping, and in their amazement they step into the trap and feel the teeth of God's word sinking into their conscience. See, Jesus' answer, first of all, revealed their misunderstanding. Verse 17, "Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's." When the Pharisees say, "Is it lawful for me to pay? Should we pay?" The word that they're using puts all the emphasis on ownership of the giver. They're saying, "Should I give my stuff to Caesar?" Then the Lord Jesus uses a different word entirely, which the ESV renders, "render." Jesus puts all the emphasis on the recipient rather than the giver. He's saying it's not yours to give. It's payment that he is owed. See, when you get your phone bill, you don't quibble over whether you're going to pay it or not. You don't look at it and say, "Am I going to give my money?" You've enjoyed the service. You've used the data. You've had the lovey-dovey phone calls with your wife all week long. Money belongs to the phone company. And that's where Jesus puts the emphasis. He's saying Caesar has a right to that money. He's provided you with protection, with government, with roads. The Romans may be corrupt, but you owe them that tax. Now, we're going to have to come back to this text next week because there's so much to pull out of this. We need to take some time to think about the real practical implications for us as Christians. For now, I want to just make two big statements. And you're going to have questions, and that's okay, but I'd encourage you to maybe wait until next Sunday and we'll hopefully answer them. First, any money that we have is from God. Every cent in every account is from God. You may have earned it, you may have sweated for every dollar, but what if God hadn't given you that body or that mind? What if you were hurt badly in that near miss on the motorbike? What if you were sick and couldn't get out of bed? Only by God's mercy do any of us have anything. Now, why is that so important? It's important because when we forget that, when we think we're the ones making the money, we'll begin to value ourselves by how much we can earn. In other words, we'll draw a line directly between the fatness of our wallets and the quality of people that we are. And suddenly, losing money, this becoming thinner, directly affects this, and so the idea of losing money becomes unbearable. It's unthinkable because losing money means losing identity. Now, the Pharisees had a double temptation. Giving money was bad. Giving money to the Romans, that was sickening. Losing my quality to improve Roman quality is unthinkable. Jesus reminds them, it's not your money. Caesar has a claim. Give to him what is rightly his. This is the one that you're going to have questions about. Second statement. Any government we have is from God. And straight away we're saying, what about those really rotten ones? What about the really corrupt ones? What about the ones who persecute Christians and run the church ragged? Next week, we'll say more next week. But don't forget, the Lord Jesus is here telling his people to pay taxes to a Roman government that was rotten to the core. None of that money was for schools or doctors or hospitals or nurses or police or firemen. Those are all things that we benefit from, things we wouldn't want to be without. And so for now, let's just make this simple point. It would be totally wrong for a Christian to be dodging their taxes. Taking Caesar's benefits whilst denying him what he deserves is sin. It's blatant disobedience to Jesus' command. Jesus' answer reveals that, and then he reveals their sin. See, giving to Caesar isn't the most important thing. We don't want to focus on that and miss the great thrust of this passage. The most important thing is giving to God what is God's. This is where the trap digs deep into these men's hearts. See, everything Jesus has been doing and saying in Jerusalem since the triumphal entry, since coming in, has one big point. Cursing a fig tree, clearing the temple, the parable of the vineyard, all has one point: giving God what is rightfully his. Jesus is saying Israel has not given God what is his. God has opened the books of heaven, and Israel is found desperately wanting. He's asked for worship. They've given lip service. They've given religion rather than repentance, circumcision of bodies, but not hearts. They offered God leaves, not fruit. Caesar's image was on that denarius coin. It was saying, he owned the coin. This is mine. He's the reason it exists. And his empire is the reason that it's valuable. Now, what does God claim to own? Psalm 24, verse 1, the earth is the Lord's. And everything in it. The world and all who live in it. Colossians goes even further. Doesn't just talk about physical things. For in him all things were created. Things in heaven and on earth. Visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. Caesar owned the whole empire. But he put his face on the money. Because it was valuable. And it went to every corner of his kingdom, a great reminder to everyone of his reign. Genesis 1:27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. This God who made everything, who has a claim not just to physical things, but the entire cosmos, has made one thing in his image. And that's you. You know, men marvel at animals and mountains and stars. Some spend their whole lives fascinated with angels and demons. None of those were made in the image of God. People travel the world to find value and meaning. It's all in the mirror. It's all right in front of your face. You're made in the image of God. God chose you over everything else to have an ability to reflect his own character. The only autographed artwork in the collection of creation is you. He put a conscience, an eternity in your heart. And do you see the obligation that puts you under? Imagine a Hollywood couple adopt a war orphan. Give him a home and a family. He's safe from bullets, safe from gangs of thugs, safe from the sex trade, safe from scratching a living in the shadow of death, safe to enjoy the love of parents and the company of generous friends. You think that child should be the best behaved child in all the world, given his privileges. If he grew up to be a rat who broke his mother's heart, you'd be furious. And yet all of us have done this with God. We've not given God what is God's. We've taken his blessings, squandered them on ourselves. We've wasted our minds on conspiracy theories and fantasies and cults and too much TV, pornography. Wasted our bodies on gluttony, drugs and drink. Wasted our hearts on gossip and love of money and chasing the approval of friends. What would you do with such a wicked child that God has blessed so thoroughly and who's thrown it all back in his face? What did God do? He sent his son to save us. 33 years, Jesus showed us how we should live. Every minute, giving to God what is God's. And it wasn't a chore. Don't think that this life of obedience to God was a chore. There was never a happier man than Jesus Christ. Men looked at him and hated him because his life, his light, revealed their failure, and so he was crucified. He always gave to Caesar what was Caesar's. There was no legal precedent for his death. And he always gave to God what is God's. There was no moral grounds for his death, and yet God allowed his son to go to the cross and crushed him as our substitute. He gave Jesus our sin, and to all who repent, he gives Jesus perfection. Caesar put his face on the coin because he valued it. God values you immensely. You're made in his image. Caesar put his image on the coin so it would be seen throughout the whole empire. As we just draw to a close, let me show you how all this ties in beautifully with mission. There's an archaeologist, an explorer, a real Indiana Jones type, and he discovers a lost city. And all through this city there are great columns, kind of 5 foot tall, covered in moss and dirt and time. And yet as his team go to work and excavate, they realize they're not columns at all. They're actually statues, busts of a great king. They're just weathered and deformed and ugly and hard to see. And as they work and as they chip away at all the age that's built up over the years, as the team excavates, the image of this noble king reappears. It's what the Lord Jesus is doing in your life, Christian. Here are 40 men and women made in God's image, ruined by sin, being restored by God's Spirit and his word. As we read and do his word, as we listen to it preached and put it into practice, the Lord Jesus makes us more like himself. He restores God's image in us, changing our actions and our attitudes, enabling us to show something of God's character in our own life as our whole lives come more into line with Christ's. We're giving to God what is God's. His image in us. Now that's who he sends to the four corners of the world. It's who he sends to Wyndham and throughout his empire. image bearers. Reflections of himself to challenge others and remind the world of what it should be, to show by our damage that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. To show by our sanctification we're not as we should be, but through Christ there's a way back to God for ruined people. Let's pray.